Schubert. Well, it's really wonderful to see all of you here. Welcome to this year's Rayson Huang Lecture. And I'm sure our much beloved and late Vice President, Vice Chancellor, I should say, Rayson Huang, would be delighted that we have such a great musician giving this lecture today, or a dialogue with me today, because he loved music and he founded not only this lecture, but also the music department. So that's Rayson Huang. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Paul Lewis. I don't know whether he needs an introduction because he's one of the great pianists of our time, no? I was going to say living pianist, but obviously that's very obvious that you're living. But one of the great pianists of our time. And also, you know, he's played with all the leading orchestras. He's done some remarkable, highly acclaimed recordings, particularly of the Beethoven and Schubert piano sonata cycles, but lately also Haydn and late Brahms. So a lot of stuff, a lot of excellent recordings. And he's also here, which is terrific. So please welcome Paul. So Paul, welcome to Hong Kong again. It's so nice to have a conversation with you again. So you've been on tour, is that right?
Yes, this whole month. This is my last week away of this particular tour. Started in Australia, and then Korea, Singapore, and now here.
So you left the last.
Best to last.
The best to last. Yes, the climax of your tour is here. And he's here to give two performances, but this is actually just the first installment of a two-year program. So two performances this year of Schubert's piano sonatas, so six sonatas coming up. And then next year you'll be back, which is terrific.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for doing that. It's going to be terrific and very exciting. So I hope you all have your tickets for that. Now, we're going to just have a conversation together about playing Schubert and hanging out with Schubert as a pianist and so on. So later, if there's time, if you have questions, we'll try and have some questions as well. So if you want to be formulating those questions, it will be great. So let me begin very simply, Paul, by saying that, you know, professors of music are not as good as musicians when talking about music, because musicians have to know every single note of a piece. So you know every single note of these Schubert sonatas, and you've thought about every single note. So what is it like for you to have to embody, as it were, Schubert, all this music, all these notes, and to live with Schubert as you prepare for this mega cycle of Schubert sonatas? What is
it
like?
I don't know if I'm any good at talking about music, really. I mean, I might know every note. It remains to be seen if I can play every note. And if I can talk about every note, that's another step. But we'll try. I mean, it's, you know, I've played Schubert for, well, more than half my life now. I mean, since I was at school, really. I'm now 50. And since I was a teenager at school, I began to be drawn to Schubert. And when I got to college, that's when I started to sort of take it more seriously. 20 years ago, I did the same cycle that I'm doing now, all the completed sonatas. And it was just out of love, really. I didn't want to sort of prove anything or, you know, make a point about anything or demonstrate. It's pure indulgence, really. I thought, well, I love this music. Wouldn't it be great to spend a year with it and just playing all these pieces? And I remember that year very vividly. It was quite a stormy year. It really felt like it was my relationship, you know, my personal relationship.
Your personal relationship with Schubert sonatas. That's very sad.
Yeah, it's a bit of a loner kind of thing, isn't it? I mean, but it was very up and down. You know, it was very stormy in good and bad ways. But you know, Schubert, for me, the core of Schubert is his humanity, what he expresses in his music, the fragility and the vulnerability of what it is to be human. And Schubert never shied away from that. You know, he didn't seek to resolve or find solutions or answers to things. It's always a case of, you know, this is it, this is reality, this is what we're dealing with. And there's a lot of nostalgia in Schubert, thinking back to things that you can't have anymore, which in his case, you know, after a certain point was his health, because he was, I suppose we'll get on to that particular A minor sonata, that there's a point in his life in 1823 when he was given a diagnosis of syphilis. And that was the point that everything changed in his music, because he knew his life would be different from that point on. And it's so clear and so raw in his music. And he doesn't try to find a way. It's not like, you know, some composers who were going through incredibly difficult times wrote, you know, rather sort of cheery music. You think, you know, writing music may have been a kind of therapy for them. In Schubert's case, it wasn't that at all. It was, this is the reality. And when you play Schubert, you have to try to somehow, it's really difficult to put into words, but somehow inhabit that space. That space in terms of sound and harmony and melody. But it's partly just believing in it. I think believing in it and feeling it very strongly at least takes you halfway there.
So when you say there's this frailty, human frailty in Schubert, and this kind of lack of being able to provide heroic answers to some of the big questions that he asks in his music, I mean, what kind of music are you thinking about in these sonatas that sort of expresses that sense of sort of fragility for you?
Well, all of them. Really, if you listen to a Beethoven sonata, I know we don't want to compare into Beethoven too much,
poor,
really.
Poor Schubert, he always gets compared with Beethoven. Poor guy. <Yeah. laughs> But let's do that anyway.
Yeah, but let's do it. It's the more I play Schubert and the more I play Beethoven, the more different they become. You know, the more you notice that they really have very little to do with each other in terms of their approach to composing. But with Beethoven, you get to the end of a piece, you feel that, of course, there's a journey there. You've come to the end point. There's a point at which there's a resolution, you know, that the journey is complete. You never feel that with Schubert. You feel that there's the journey, but nothing's resolved. You know, you come to the, there's no, Schubert never has the triumphalism of Beethoven, for instance. That just doesn't exist. Schubert either fades away, you get the impression that he could actually have gone on even longer, you know, and he does go on quite long in a lot of his big pieces. But there's just not that sense of resolution. It hangs in the air. And to me, that makes him the most human composer of all, because we don't have the answers to everything. We might like to think that we do, but you know, and it gives us a security to come up with an answer. But actually, in a lot of cases, we don't. And that's something incredibly honest about that with Schubert, I find.
Yes, he never manages to sort of transcend like Beethoven does, right? And that he just leaves you kind of hanging in midair sometimes.
Whereas, you know, Beethoven's last piano sonata, Opus 111, in the late period, you know, you find that heroism and triumphalism that you might find in the middle period with Beethoven, that's gone. He asks questions, he sort of presents struggles, and then he just rises above it. You know, he just kind of, he just floats above it. He sort of goes to a better place where none of that matters. Schubert doesn't do that. Schubert is very much in the moment with that, I find.
I mean, you're playing the big D major sonata this time around, and that's not a particularly, you know, tragic sonata, but yet, I mean, it's a big, it begins kind of heroically, I mean, it's massive. Yeah. And yet, if you think about it, you know, the finale is not trying to answer any heroic questions.
No, not at all. I mean, the finale is, I think, you know, a lot of people find that a bit of a conundrum, the finale, because the D major, it's one of his biggest pieces. It's a very difficult piece. The first movement is hugely symphonic, kind of bordering on virtuosic. It's that kind of thing. Second movement is, again, another huge movement, and it has this sense of choral music. It's, you could transcribe it for a choir quite easily, I think. In the first movement, you've had a lot of mountain music. It's very outdoorsy, you know, there's a lot of mountain sounds, and there's even yodeling, and there's waterfalls, and, you know, all this comes into it. The third movement, the scherzo, is also mountain music. It's very kind of, in maybe in more of a Viennese way. And then the last movement is this innocent little march. You think, well, How does that fit in? It's all innocence and can sound quite twee in a way.
Yes, if odd.
Yeah. It can sound a bit sort of precious, but it shouldn't, because I think the B section, the C sections that you know we hear in between the times that we hear the march, tell us that all isn't quite as it appears, and then when we hear the march again and again, we hear it slightly differently through the experience that we've had. And that's one of Schubert's things, you know.
We might want to remind the audience what it sounds like.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking maybe they don't know what we're talking about.
Well, this is the march theme, you know. Couldn't be simpler, really. Very straightforward, totally innocent, you know, no trouble.
Yes, and it's nothing like, I mean, the opening of the sonata is just the complete opposite.
Yeah, I mean, it's very joyful, but it's huge.
Huge.
It's
huge.
Straight away, you get right into the minor.
So, that's, you know, a very Schubertian movement.
Very Schubertian.
Yes. We'll talk a little bit more about that as well. But there is a sense. So this, you know, this march is very dinky. But as you're saying, is it not as dinky as it might seem?
No, because there is there are middle sections with quite a lot of drama. The B section, the first other section that we hear, is quite driven. You know, in the way that the march isn't. We then come back to the march, which is a variation of the theme. There are more notes. And then we get the C section, which is actually quite dramatic and quite troubled in a way. And then when we hear the theme, the march theme for the last time, there are even more notes. You know, it's busier, it's a more elaborate variation. So we feel that every time we hear the march, there's more substance to it. And I think...
Yeah. I mean, you know, in a way, Schubert, after that diagnosis, in whatever it was, 1822, 23, the music, in one sense, loses its innocence. I mean, there's a lot of innocent music. You still hear that kind of very lyrical, innocent music. I mean, it crops up all the time.
Yeah.
But somehow, it's an innocence that's lost.
Yeah. It's the same innocent music with a completely different color, somehow. And again, it's because of the music that surrounds it. It's what he puts around it that alters our perception of it. I think, I mean, before the diagnosis, you get, you know, a lot of lyricism, of course, huge beauty in Schubert, very melodic, and a kind of, there's a sort of, well, the Germans call it Sehnsucht, you know, this feeling of longing for something. But it's in a very beautiful way. After the diagnosis, the longing turns into something else. You know, sort of it's bitter nostalgia.
You're playing two early sonatas. I think the E flat major and the A major, the very popular A major.
Yeah.
I mean, that's lyrical in a sense that is innocent and, you know, with a little bit of romantic yearning. But it's pretty much, I mean, it's pretty much all the way through.
Yeah.
Lyrically innocent. I mean,
it is. Apart from, you know, there's one bit in the middle of the first movement, but it's the storm clouds. You know, they sort of blow away quite quickly. You know that this. You know, and the whole of the exposition is emotionally kind of on that level. You know, that it doesn't fluctuate too much. And in the middle section, we get. You know, so it's a little bit dramatic, a little bit stormy, but nothing to you know, rock the boat.
No, it's just
too much.
In the teacup, really.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, no, but then, you know, with the A minor, you're referring to the A minor sonata, D7, whatever.
784,
A minor sonata, that is the game changer in the whole series. Is it the case that it really what you hear there is just completely different? It's a new kind of Schubert that changes everything. And what is that difference? What is that change?
Well, I've put that in, it's in tomorrow's program. The first piece in the program is the earlier and very lyrical and quite untroubled E-flat sonata. Yes, you know, so in very much in that character. And then comes the A minor. So it's the biggest contrast in terms of Schubert's world, really. You know, he just hadn't written anything quite as sparse as this. It's single notes, silences. It's the point at which silence becomes incredibly significant in Schubert's music, you know, as significant as the sound. So the opening of the A minor sonata. At the end of the theme, you get this, which he separates. You know, he sort of phrases that on its own. These two, and that turns into, and later, you know, it's this kind of this sort of tolling bell in the distance that becomes incredibly angry and raw. There's nothing that doesn't exist in his music before that point.
Yeah. I mean, it's like a funeral. I mean, it's a funeral march in many ways.
Yeah, It's sort of trudging to your fate.
Yes, yes. And that kind of all those bare octaves again, just refusal to have anything lush or lyrical.
Yeah.
Even. You know, I think you said somewhere that you know you have to know the songs.
Yeah.
To really play these sonatas, and it reminds me that A minor always. Reminds me of the final song in Winterreiser, where you have the same, you know, it's a dilemma, the organ grinder, where you have the same sense of complete bareness and a desolate landscape. And he seems to be painting that. And that seems to be, this seems to be the beginning of that kind of language.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, that dilemma, you know, that song. And all the way through, the bass never changes. Every bar is the same.
Yeah, and that refusal to end. I mean, that's, you know,
yeah.
He doesn't end that, you know, that melodic line, and that happens a lot.
Yeah.
In the A minor sonata, where you know these,
yeah.
He doesn't hit that final cadence.
That's right. Yeah.
And it just goes back.
Yeah.
Into this rotational thing. Yeah. And it's also the sonata where he also discovers a new language in the textures. A lot of tremolos. I mean, the development section is very much. Very expansive and full of these kind of textures that are ominous in many ways. And I think that's also a new kind of tone, or not just tone, it's got color in Schubert.
Yeah. He could write very orchestrally, and I think there are a lot of string tremolandi in the Wonder of Fantasy, you know, that they exist. Not playing the Wonder of Fantasy in this series, but that's possibly his most orchestral piece, you know, and there's a lot of tremolandi and in that, yeah.
Yeah, but this one, these tremolos are kind of the ominous ones. They'll turn up again on and on in the Schubert sonatas. But the last one being the famous, the B flat major, where you have this kind of the tune, and then you have this, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of these, the Schubert sonatas after the A minor or during with the A minor has these kind of interruptions.
Yeah.
In it that really make things a little bit strange, even in moments of idyllic recollection.
Yeah, and you think Schubert is the most vocal of all composers, inevitably. You know, it was with all the songs he composed and how he wrote for the voice, and you know you have that translated into the piano music. So when he cuts it short, you know, when you're expecting a phrase to end and you just get silence. It's like you stop breathing. You know, it's not what you expect from him at all, and that's what makes the silences so profound and so meaningful.
In the same A minor sonata, I think the third movement, the not very happy scherzo, very grim scherzo, but it also has a moment of idyll. I mean, of you know, F major
In 845.
Yeah. I'm 845. Yeah. So yes. It has that moment, but it's still, I mean, not innocent, as it were.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, we'd like to sort of just sort of show that a little bit about what we mean in terms. When
things
seem so nice, so, but they're not.
Yes. So in the big A minor sonata 845, the third movement, he calls it a scherzo. I suppose, you know, so sometimes he was very conventional, you know, but the music's anything but conventional. But there's nothing very funny about this. It's such a restless character, this. You know, I mean, harmonically, it jumps everywhere. It flits from one place to another. It can't rest. So that's the scherzo, and the trio section is just an extraordinary minute or so of music. So he goes from A minor to F major. So if I play the end of the scherzo, can't play it as soft as I want to play it in this room, but it's triple piano. It's, you know, pianissimo. It should sound like it's coming from a different place. You know, this is the thing about Schubert's nostalgia. There's so much memory in his music, and this is something for me that this really represents. You know, there's something soothing about this music, and there's a yum bum bum kind of rocking and all that. But it's gone. You know, that's what makes it so awful. The fact that it's just the memory of something soothing, the memory of being comforted.
Yes, yeah. So, you know, compared to those early sonatas, this is actually much spookier in one sense that it appears like this, which is why you need to find the quietest piano you can.
That's right, yeah. Play it. You need a good soft pedal.
Yeah, exactly. So you're playing both the, you know, big A minor sonatas in this concert, and both of them end with this kind of crazy, very fast, blustery whirlwind, which always, going back to his songs again, reminds us of this famous kind of elf king kind of chasing, you know, sort of Ikonic kind of music, where it's describing the father and his son on a horse galloping away from this very strange elf king figure that's basically death about to grab them. But of course, that was written when he was fairly young. I mean, he wasn't thinking about it.
He
Schubert.
Was 17.
Yeah, I mean, really, I mean, that could have made his name in many ways. This is a setting of a Goethe poem. But actually, it comes back to haunt him, because this kind of music then becomes this whirlwind where really he's in that song.
Yeah, he becomes that story, which is so, I mean, that's the tragedy of it. But how he's able to translate it into music is just extraordinary. But you need to, you know, in order to convey it, you need to try to just crawl right inside it, and that's what I meant when, you know, 20 years ago when I played this cycle, it was a stormy time. You try to inhabit the music, it inhabits you. You know, it sort of takes you in a way that's, you know, there's a lot of ups and downs.
Yeah, if you want Schubert as a companion, beware.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but you'll also be playing maybe a less known sonata, an incomplete one in one sense, that goes with the second A minor sonata, which is the reliquia, seemingly C major sonata.
Yeah,
and you'll just be playing two movements. This is the one where the third movement, the scherzo, is not finished, and then the finale is just only about 34 bars or something like that. But you're just going to play two movements. I mean, does it work like that?
For me, it's a complete sonata. When I say that, I'm playing all the sonatas that he completed. This is actually incomplete, technically speaking. You can see the unfinished movements. But there's a perfection to these two movements, and the slow movement is it's so unusual for a slow movement, and where it takes you, where you get to at the end of it. is, you know, with Schubert's sense of irresolution, and it just hangs in the air. What could you say after that? I mean, actually, if you play what he wrote, you know, the beginning of the third movement, it just doesn't seem to work. You know, it's odd. There's nothing more you can say at the end of that slow movement. And to me, that's probably why he didn't complete
it's
it.
It's finished. You know, it's already finished.
It's finished, yeah. There really is a perfection to it. The second movement has, there's a sort of sense of a dance of death about it, whereas the first movement is much more positive in character and much more symphonic. And I think these two things just complement each other perfectly, really.
This is one of those pieces by Schubert where you know it's in C major, but you always go away thinking, was that in a major key, right? I mean, of course, the second movement, I think, must be C minor, right?
It is, yeah.
But even the first movement has the moments where you think, is that really, you know, in a major mode? I have this with the G major string quartet, where I was thinking, it must be in a minor key, right? Yes. But this is another trait of Schubert, where it's so tragic that the major sounds minor.
Yeah. Well, in that, you know, there's something that really doesn't sound major about that in the context in which he puts it. There's a moment in the C major, so in the reliquary, it's very C majory. It's monothematic. The second theme really is completely derived from the first theme, which is unique in Schubert. It's really unusual in his piano sonatas. But he modulates from C major to B minor for the second theme, which geographically, you know, is miles away in harmonically. But how does he get there? You know, it's he writes this crunching kind of dissonance, which turns into a B minor chord. But it's like this. You know, you get the, so we're in C major. There's something about the pain of that chord, which gives us that transition into B minor, which is really significant in his music as well. It's kind of, you know, it's the effort of how we get there that's part of how he writes.
Of course, there's this thing about Schubert where these types of chords, just individual chords, and the way you play and space them,
yeah,
is very important.
Yeah, how you voice them.
Exactly,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I think in the last conversation, we talked about Alfred Brendel, and I think I asked you to play the beginning of, how would you play the beginning of the Beethoven fourth piano?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And the G major sonata. I mean, it's the same kind of chord, but
yeah,
completely different.
It's that compared to... Yeah, yeah, it's all in the voicing. It's all in the color. I mean, you can make a major chord sound minor almost just in the way you voice it.
Exactly. You know? Yeah. And do you find that, because since this is your second cycle, that these types of details become more acute to you now that you don't have to just learn it and do it as it were, quickly, but now you're coming back to it, so you can have more time to contemplate the music.
Yeah, it feels different. I mean, I wouldn't do it again 20 years later if I didn't feel that I could do something different. And actually listening to recordings of concerts from when I played it 20 years ago, I think, God, it sounds a bit bland, you know? I mean, you know, I sort of color that differently now. And yeah, it is very different. And at the time, some of the sonatas I was just learning and playing for the first time. So yeah, I think as things settle, you know, you let things rest for a bit. You play lots of other things, you live your life, you have your experience, and you come back to something that you know, or you think you know, and then it appears differently to you.
What is the biggest difference between the, you know, your understanding now and then?
I think it's a lot of it is in what we've been talking about, you know, the role of silence, the significance of silence in his music. And how you build tension in a way that makes the silence all the more telling. you know, that's different, I think, now, 20 years later. I see Schubert as a much darker composer in general compared to those early years.
Right. So with this new emphasis on silence, and, well, I mean, in a way, you've become more, in one sense, more expansive. I mean, Schubert has always been a composer of the great expanse and the endless repetition. And I would imagine that would be one of the greatest challenges of playing Schubert anyway.
Yeah.
And how do you handle, you know, a music that doesn't want to keep going forward, driving towards cadences, but just sort of, you know, just happens, you know, in that way. I mean, and now that you are lingering further with the silences and stuff, I mean, how do you keep it all together? I mean, it must be a huge challenge to be able to play Schubert in a structural way so that it hangs together, given all that.
I think the key is knowing when to drive it and knowing when to step back, really. Because there is this famous Alfred Brendel quote about Schubert where he sleepwalks through his music, or he navigates through his music with the assurance of a sleepwalker. You know, it's like you just can't see where you're going, but you know where you're going. It's that kind of thing. Whereas, again, to make the comparison with Beethoven, poor Schubert.
No, I was just wanted to go back to the music, because we talked about the C major as it were fragmentary but total sonata, but he wrote that at the same time with that A minor, the second A minor sonata that you'd be playing, the other famous one, which is 8-4-5, right?
Yeah.
So, do you hear correspondence between those two sonatas, because one he finished and one he didn't finish, but both are equally tragic.
Yeah. The A minor is a much more extrovert piece in a way than the C major. It's more sort of obviously angry. There's a lot of anger. It's for me that this big A minor is a sort of evolution of the earlier A minor, the syphilis sonata, if we can call it that. It's, you know,
syphilis, but worse.
Yes, but much worse. So the A minor is full of drama and full of tension and full of anger.
I will need to remind the audience how it begins.
Well, this is the thing, So the C major, which doesn't have that same character, starts with an upbeat. And then these chords. And the A minor that he was writing at the same time starts with this upbeat. And then chords. So there's something in the template that's very similar there. But the characters of those pieces couldn't be more different. You know, and the direction he takes them in. Obviously, you know, the C major, he didn't take it in the direction he probably initially thought he was going to take it in, whereas the A minor, the way it ends is just devastating. You know, it's such a whirlwind of distress, that piece.
And the A minor is the one where I think there's always this, the typical Schubert trait of repeated notes that it always sounds, if it's fate about to knock you, the nails in your coffin. Yes. There's this very angry music in that.
But so, like you said, you know, it can have so many different characters. Yes. So in the D major, we're breathing in this mountain air. And in the last movement of the G major, there's your village bandit. You know, we're all sort of sitting around and about to dance. And in the A minor, so different, but yeah, you're right. That figure, it does feature a lot.
It's a very Schubertian figure, but it's everywhere. So you know, you've been doing this this cycle, and it's the second time of doing this cycle. So it's, you know, it's very meaningful, and it's coming around to do it again. And then you're now 50, and you just do all this, you know, which is great. I'm just wondering whether in doing it this time around, whether you have also a different characterization of Schubert. In other words, a different companion, in a way, than the first time around, where he was, you know, a companion. But this time, is he still that same guy?
He is, but maybe I understand him slightly better. there's less friction. I kind of know what to expect a bit more than before. I think I was 20 years ago in the process of really, you know, still getting to know Schubert. And, you know, having said that, I'm still getting to know Schubert because, you know, you never stop. I think that the way I'd characterize him now is along the same lines, but just more nuanced than before. I think I see Schubert these days as a composer of such huge range. It was a little bit black and white to me 20 years ago. But these days I think the possibilities are just endless with Schubert, the character of his music.
So for, you know, it's actually quite a challenge to listen to, you know, a lot of Schubert piano sonatas in one go. It's not like an easy kind of concert in a way. And I'm just wondering what, I don't know what the word is, advice, or how do you advise, particularly a novice, you know, coming to this music, coming to hear you play this, you know, coming for the first time, what's the best way in? How should you engage with this kind of music?
I think trust it. You know, just trust. I mean, this is the thing that I think we were talking about with Schubert, and the space of Schubert, the span of Schubert. He often, especially later, writes these huge movements. How do you go about presenting that? How do you make it hang together? You know, how do you make it feel like a journey? Trusting it is the most important thing. That's the first step. It was interesting because we talked about Schubert's tempo markings, you know,
yes.
Moderato. Yeah,
he's Mr. Moderato.
He's Mr. Moderato, whereas, you know, you'd see Allegro con brio and Allegro vivace, or, you know, sort of these kind of modifications to Allegro. If Schubert writes Allegro, it's most likely to be Allegro Moderato,
yes.
You know. Even in the B-flat, there's even Molto Moderato. More moderato than moderato.
Yes. How moderate can you be?
Yeah, I think moderato gets a bit of a bad press sometimes because people think, oh, moderato, what doesn't mean anything, does it? Does it mean neutral? What does it mean?
It's neither here nor there.
It's not one thing or another. But I think what Schubert's doing is he's inviting you to trust him. You know, so this is a huge piece. This is, you know, it's a big expanse that we're embarking on here, this expansive journey. Don't try to modify it. Don't try to make it more interesting, because you won't. You know, just trust me with the space that I'm inhabiting here.
Right, moderato, sometimes andante, is like,
yeah.
He's just walking, and he wants you to walk with him.
That's
trust
right.
me, I'm not really lost.
Yeah, you know, there's no presto. In faster movements, it's something moderato. And in the slow movements, it's andante. You know, there's very rarely an adagio. There's a slow movement of the C minor sonata, one of the last three, is adagio. But you know, that's the exception, really. So andante and moderato are quite close together. You know, his tempi are generally somewhere in the middle. But I think from a listener's point of view, it's really important to have that trust too, to just go with the flow, if you like, and, you know, sort of inhabit the space as well.
Yeah, it's about being rather than getting into a fast car kind of experience.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. If Schubert's sort of leading you, you know, and he's sleepwalking, you have to trust that sleepwalker that he knows where he's going.
But for the pianist, I mean, you know, you're a great interpreter of Schubert because you're not over-interpreting. It's very tempting to over-interpret those moments, right?
Yeah.
When you don't really trust him.
And that's what I really try not to do. I don't react well when I hear other people over-interpret or, you know, sort of impose themselves on something. Because, you know, what are you saying? Am I more interesting than this music? No, I'm not at all. And the focus should be, you know, again, it just comes down to trust. It's trusting the person that composed this music, that this is more interesting than you can ever make it, really. You know, you can only make it sound worse than it is. That's all you can do. So the best you can do is to try to allow it to speak for itself.
How do you get the structure across then if it's kind of feels like it's kind of meandering and endless expanse of, you know, modulatory space?
Yeah, I mean, that's a big question. People talk about structure in music. From a musicological point of view, of course you can explain structure. How do you convey it in a performance? It's a very elusive one. It's hard to put into words, but I think there are two things. One is characterization. So if you imagine your sonata as a play, you know, in which there are various characters on stage, you have to be clear about what those characters are. So they're kind of like anchor points, you know, that you're always aware of where you are, that they kind of give you a sense of orientation in a piece. And the other is pulse. I wouldn't use the word tempo. I think tempo and pulse are two different things. But I imagine my basic pulse as a kind of spine. And if you always know where you are, you know, there has to be flexibility of pulse, but you should always know exactly where you are and come back to this spine, if you like, this basic tempo. I think these are two fundamental things that can actually convey a sense of unity or of structure, if you like, in a performance.
Well, that's amazing. I think, you know, we can hear that in your playing, which is why we love it so much. I think we should open the time for a few questions. I don't know whether you have questions, but I hope you do. And we have a mic. So there are the ABCs of asking a question in my presence. A is be articulate. Okay, so make sure you have a mic and speak your question clearly. B is be brief. And this is not a time for you to do a review of Paul's greatest works. And C is be centered. Please, you know, talk about what we talked about today and not about Brahms. Okay, so are there questions?
I'm not sure if you've addressed the question of what to make of the finale of the 850. Yeah, despite all the stormy stuff in the middle, there's an apparent innocence. So how do you approach it? Do you think this in this piece or in any of Schubert's, there's any irony or anything to be taken ironically or what do you think of it?
So we're dealing with the D major
sonata.
Right, we've played a little bit of that march.
I don't think there is irony in Schubert, to be honest. You know, and I think irony is a big feature of a lot of. I mean, there's irony in Haydn. There's irony in Beethoven, for sure. But not Schubert. I think Schubert is too kind of honest and maybe earnest in a way to be ironic. I think in the case of the last movement of the D major, you know, you have this innocence to start with, and you have something that's a bit more driven, a bit more anxious. Then you hear the innocence in a different way. Then you hear something that's more dramatic and stormy. And then you get the march theme again. What he's doing, at least to my way of thinking, is he's bringing you back to reality every time. He's kind of saying, well, you know, life goes on. This march theme is the anchor point. That's, you know, we always come back to that. And despite the fact that there are these other things happening that alter our perception of the way we hear the march theme, there's something constant about it. You know, he does, like I said before, he doesn't answer. He doesn't solve anything. It's just the way it is. That's kind of what he's doing.
He does that a lot too with the dance type themes as well. The music just, you know, like you've eavesdropped on some sort of village dance, and you hear that, and you just hear that. But it's kind of sad that he's where he is, but that's reality. It's still, life goes on.
Yeah.
It's that kind of, I don't know whether it's not really irony, but it's...
Yeah, but it's like, well, you know, that's all happening. I've got my issues. They're not going away.
And they're not dealing with it either.
No.
This question here.
About the various incomplete sonatas, you've told us why the Reliquiae Sonata D840 belongs in the canon in your cycles. Concerning the others, are you not tempted to mix things up a bit and include the F minor, the F sharp minor sonatas? Sounds like not.
No, I mean, the F sharp minor, for instance, 625, that's a very easy one to reconstruct. First movement is unspeakably beautiful. And then he sets up, I don't want to be nasty about you, he sets up, as he quite often did in the early period, one of his subdominant recaps. So, you know, in the exposition, he starts in F sharp minor and ends in the dominant. So all he has to do when he comes to the recapitulation, start in the subdominant and transpose exactly the same music, and he ends in the tonic again. So he sets that up, so all you have to do is transpose the exposition. It's very easy to play that piece. And I've done it, of course, and I kind of understand why he left it, because for all its beauty, it's very much on the same level. I mean, it's all emotionally, it's kind of the same thing. And it's the sort of thing that I play for myself, play for my own pleasure. I feel to get that across in a performance is just a bit too tricky, you know, for it to be gripping in a way, to be able to take people with you. And some of the other early sonatas, which are kind of complete but not, like the C major 279, I think it's 279, with a third movement, which is a minuet and trio that in A minor, you know, obviously he kind of didn't think of that as being the end of it. And the A flat 557, the last movement is in E flat major, and kind of, you know, some of these cases where, you know, I think these were individual pieces that just ended up put in a kind of with other movements and became sonatas. I'm not convinced they were conceived as sonatas. That's why I'm not tempted to do that.
but that is a part of Schubert that maybe we should touch on as well. That kind of the sense in which, how can I put it? It's like the Biedermeier, the time in which, you know, Napoleon's over, right, in Vienna. So 1815, the Congress of Vienna happens. You know, Wellington's victory over Napoleon has happened in Waterloo. And so actually nobody's thinking about revolution and heroism anymore. And so you have Schubert, and he's really just living on the outskirts of Vienna. He's hanging out within small communities. You know, he's not in the middle, he's not sort of in the urban middle. And he doesn't have to think philosophically about anything. And it's a time when everybody wants to just get back to normal. So when you hear that kind of very lyrical Schubert that we were, you know, playing with those early sonatas, in a way, it's just Divini saying, let's just get back to normal.
Yeah.
Because we can't take any more of this, you know, heroic Beethovenian, you know, Napoleonic stuff anymore. You know, the whole of Europe has been devastated by this, and we just want to go back.
Yeah.
And that's definitely the kind of Schubert I hear,
right?
Until he gets that premonition of his own death, and then it becomes not a heroism, but that kind of it sort of grips his music in ways that takes it into a great direction. Actually, even though it's tragic,
And what to me, what makes that all the more powerful is that he doesn't shout it at you. You know, it's the introspection of Schubert. Introspection being such a huge feature of his music, but when it becomes tragic, that's the worst thing of all. You know, it's what really eats you up. It's Schubert's not inability. He can scream, and he does scream plenty of times. But what stays with you is that introspective tragedy. That to me is the most powerful thing of all.
And it leads to really we're not going to hear them this time around, so we have to give a kind of taster. But
right.
Really to the last sonatas, right? Mm-hmm. Because the journey, these 12 sonatas that you're taking, it's the 12 years of Schubert's life, as it were, almost.
Yeah.
And it is a journey, but it's an aesthetic journey as well.
Yeah.
It takes you, it doesn't transcend. We didn't know that, but it does take you into extraordinary places where some of the greatest music ever written suddenly happens.
Yeah.
Could you say a few things about the late?
The last three sonatas.
Yes, the last three.
Yeah, I mean, the last three, it's interesting because Schubert, you have the last three, the C minor, 958, A major, 959, and B flat, 960. The C minor sonata, Schubert wrote on the top of the manuscript, sonata one. And so he conceived these last three as a set. And there really is a journey there. The C minor is a hugely troubled piece, incredibly dramatic, a sense of being pursued. You know, the 6-8 last movement, a kind of Tarantella-like movement. Ba-dum, 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 ba-dum. You feel like you're being, you know, that you're trying to escape something, But he can't, of course, because he doesn't resolve it. It's exactly that. And it chases him all the way to the end of the movement. And from that, you get the A major sonata, which is such an incredibly heartfelt piece of music, also has a dignity about it, kind of holds its head up high. But that doesn't preclude the middle section of the slow movement, which is the most bizarre and anarchic thing he wrote. You know, that there's no logic to it at all. It really is like a scream from the gut. And that to me is the last time he does that in the piano music. After that, there's a sense of acceptance or resignation. That you feel at the end of the long finale of the A major, where he uses this theme, which he clearly loved because he uses the same theme in an earlier sonata, in the A minor sonata, the early one. And in the last movement of the big A major. The same theme, and at the end of that, at the end of the piece, you have a short presto section. You think it's that the piece is going to end in a sort of flurry of fast triplets. It doesn't. The silence. It comes back to silence, and then you get. That this theme to him is like his dearest friend. He doesn't want to let go of it. And then the F natural. It's like letting go of your best friends, of your biggest love's hand for the last time. You know it's going to be for the last time. That's the feeling I get. So you've in the way the A major, there's a sense of an end of something, and then you have the B flat, which you know, significantly, one semitone up, feels like you've already entered a different space. This is something beyond. You know, there's a sense of otherworldliness about this piece. For me, that's the journey of the last three sonatas, and for all Schubert's irresolution. In a way, what the B flat does is a little bit of what Beethoven does in 111 at the end. You know, he just rises above and leaves it behind, but with a sense of acceptance and no regrets. And I think that's just such a wonderful journey.
He gets there in the end.
Yeah, he does.
He really does get
there. He does, yeah.
Just in time. Yeah, no. Maybe just one last question from me, because you know, we talked about Schubert and this journey through the sonatas. But I want to talk a little bit about you as a pianist and the coming from a, what's the, you know, when you do these Schubert sonatas, it's not like you're just coming out of the blue. It's not like, you know, I'm just going to learn these pieces. I mean, there's a whole tradition of Schubert that you are drawing on or inspired by. I'm just wondering, who are the pianists then that you really admire doing Schubert? I mean, that you really think, without this person, you know, I would not think of Schubert in this way.
Well, I mean, I have to say, Alfred Brendel is probably, you know, has to be my biggest influence in that respect. As I played to him when I was still a student in London, when I was 20, and he said, let's keep in touch. And then I played to him for the rest of the 90s, and I played most of these pieces to him. And to me, that was, it was like just doors opening in all directions. You know, he would, you'd hear him play and, you know, sort of love his playing, and then he would explain something. He had an incredible way of explaining music, putting music into words. And then he would demonstrate, and you think, that's what he's getting at. It took me a while to translate that into my own language in a way, and I think that was perhaps part of the problem 20 years ago, you know, when, kind of under the influence. But I think so many of the things that he put forward have really stayed and have meant a lot to me. So he's, I would say, my biggest influence, certainly in this repertoire.
And you've recorded already some of these sonatas, is that right? Of the Schubert sonata, the new cycle.
Yes, well, actually, I've recorded all the sonatas now. Right. I've recorded the last 6 years of his piano music, all the big pieces, plus these earlier sonatas. So yeah, that's kind of done.
It's done. Schubert is now done.
Well, I say that. I mean, that's well. Two of the sonatas I've actually recorded twice, which is strange these days. The C minor sonata and the A minor 784 that I'm playing tomorrow. And yeah, I sort of mentioned this yesterday because I don't listen to my recordings because they irritate the hell out of me. So I tend to avoid that. But the first recording I made of the A minor sonata in 2001, it's interesting, I did listen to it. And I was quite shocked, really. The last movement is quite slow. It's quite moderate, let's say. Yes. he doesn't write moderato with that one. And then my later recording, it's faster. But these days it's faster still. You're supposed to get slower.
Yes.
The older you get.
You're getting younger as you grow older, Paul. Which is great, which is amazing. It means, you know, your next cycle will be really fast. Yeah. It'll fit on one CD.
You can do it all in a week. Yeah.
But anyway, Paul, it's been fantastic talking to you.
Thank you.
So much insight. And lovely, of course, to hear all this wonderful music. So thank you very much for being here.
Well, thanks for having me. Thank you.